Welcome to the Benwood Johnson Podcast. You can visit Dr. Johnson's blog at benwoodpost.com. Dr. Johnson's works can be found at drbenwoodjohnson.com. You can also support Dr. Johnson on Patreon, the link to which is in the description. Hey, welcome to the Benwood Johnson Podcast. Today is April the 22nd, 2019, and this is podcast number 27. Well, I am so glad to have you back with us one more time this week. We're going to talk about a very important subject, and this is the concept of rights. In this podcast, we're going to assess the term human rights. We're going to assess what it means to have rights and what it means not to have rights. So I know this is a very, complicated subject. I don't expect today to delve into the crux of the issue to get into the bottom of what is rights. But today we're going to introduce the concept to a point where we're going to talk about, you know, the nitty-gritty of the term itself. So, yes, the concept of rights is a very popular concept. Almost everybody knows what it means because you hear folks talk about rights, where you're talking about human rights, social rights, legal rights, natural rights. This is a very common terminology to hear. Nonetheless, what does the term really mean? Now, this is where the question sort of takes a different turn. So here, I propose to talk about this term. Of course, I am going to present, at least I'm going to offer a philosophical understanding of what the term means. Nonetheless, the idea is to dissect the term rights, to try to come up with some understanding, to make sense of what it means to have rights and what it means not to have rights. So do human beings have inherent rights, or is something that, you know, the person has to be given over time? And if that is the case, then what are the implications of having to be given rights? So this is the essence of our conversation today. So I encourage you to stay tuned, and we're going to have another wonderful debate, and we're going to have a great podcast today. So without further ado, let us delve right into it. Rights. What is it? When we are talking about the notion of rights, whether we are talking about human rights or legal rights, natural rights, what is it that we are talking about? Now, this is not the first time I am debating this subject. Now, the reason this is important to talk about, it is because everything has this underlining implication in terms of rights, human rights, or legal rights. This is to say, whatever we do, however we are treated, and however we treat others, has something to do with how we perceive our rights to do, or how they perceive their rights to do. So the concept of rights is a very important concept because it underlies the foundation of society. So right off the bat, the individual is supposed to enjoy certain rights, or in many cases, those rights are defined as inalienable rights. In other words, those rights could not be taken away. That means the individual was born with those rights. Of course, there is also a religious, if not a dogmatic, approach to the concept of rights, in terms of the idea that there was a creator who gave rights to the individual. But I think if we were to look at this term from a philosophical standpoint, there is more to this concept than meets the eye. more to this concept than most people realize, and most people are willing to acknowledge. Okay, so in this podcast, let us examine the concept a little bit deeper. Okay, so what is right sin? Now, of course, we've talked about war and peace. We've talked about the concept of justice based on how Lucinda Spooner sees this, the notion of mine and thine. We've talked about that. We've also talked about Jean-Paul Sartre in terms of how he understands freedom, how he views the concept, how he sort of relegates the responsibility of freedom to the individual. But the foundation of those, and to repeat myself, is what is it that the individual is entitled to begin with? Does the individual enjoy an intrinsic right to be or not to be? Does the individual have an inherent disposition to be a certain way? Okay? These are some of the questions that philosophers, thinkers of all sorts have talked about. In fact, in my recent book, Citizen Obedience, I talked about the concept of legal obligation, in which I sort of discuss how the individual, at least the being, does not have any right which is acknowledged in society. The concept itself, when we're talking about society, the idea of maintaining order, implies that the individual at a raw state is chaotic. There's disorder. And there ought to be a milieu, in this case, a social milieu, which would instill order in the individual. And that's the role of society. Okay? So, of course, today we're not going to delve into this dichotomy between what society is and what the individual is, and how we reconcile those differences. Because society and the individual are two different entities with two different sets of needs, which, for the most part, are not compatible. Okay? So today we're not going to delve in this aspect. But we're going to stay within the realm of examining what is right. So when we ask the question, what is right, or what is a right, we have to acknowledge that answer to this question is not that easy to decipher. It's not that easy to determine, to say this is what right is, and this is how we should approach the concept. The reason being, it is because the concept of right is often understood in two different ways. The first way in which the concept is understood is within the context of a social construct. And by that I mean society decides, that is, society creates or develops over time a mechanism in which right is understood, thereby right is given to the individual. So in that sense, a right is something that every member of society, of a particular society, is entitled to having or to receiving. Okay? And that entitlement is based on the principle of morality. That entitlement is based on the notion that every human being is worth it. It means you as a human being who happens to live in a society, you, right off the bat, are worth it or worthy of something. And that worth is quantified based on the standard of humanity, which is you as a person have a fundamental right or enjoy fundamental rights. But the concept itself emanated from notions of righteousness, from notions of morality, which means there are certain things in society that ought to be a certain way. And that structure must derive from a higher power, from a higher understanding. And in this case, it is God. Now, as a disclaimer, I always point out when I am talking about God that, you know, I am not an atheist. I could never consider myself an atheist. But as a philosopher and a thinker, I've always been, at least I have always tried, to look at the concept of God from a human perspective. In other words, when I'm talking about God here, I am not trying to delineate who God is, whether there is a God, or what are the powers of that God. I am looking at the concept from a human perspective. In other words, John sees God a certain way, Joanna sees God a certain way, and when I am talking about God, I am looking at it from this prism. How John and Joanna do not see God the same way. So in that sense, the concept of God, the notion of a deity, or the notion of God itself, is somewhat subjective. So that is not to say there's no God. That is not to say I do not believe in God. So just as a disclaimer, let's keep that in mind, okay? Because this is not a conversation about denying the existence of God or promoting the existence of God. So to the extent that I am talking about God, it is not a refusal or it is not a promotion of God. It is an analysis that is purely intellectual. So let's keep that in mind. But to go back to what we were talking about, when we are talking about the concept of rights, which is based on the social construct, God is the highest power from whom rights come from. Okay? And because of that, the individual whom is created by God, based on the human understanding of the individual, that individual enjoys certain rights. Of course, like I said before, in certain, you know, societies, the concept is connected to God. And we could not talk about society without mentioning God. We ought to have a higher power from which notions of hierarchy emanated. So in this case, in most societies, if not all societies, there's always this deification of man to the extent that men derive their power from a deity, in this case, God. But this concept, at least when we're talking about rights, from the concept of a social construct, it's the idea that the individual has or enjoys certain rights which is given to him by God. However, when we look at the concept of rights from this understanding, it is a limited approach to the concept, okay? Because it is a one-sided approach to what rights is or what it could be or what the notion entails. So what that means is that when we're talking about rights, we're talking about rights from a human perspective. So what that means is that human beings enjoy rights and everything else does not. So the same moral purview that underlies the concept of rights also undermines it if we're looking at it from this particular social construct. If we're looking at it from this dogmatic, like God gave or provided rights to the individual. Because if we're looking at rights from this context, what it means is that I, as a human being, have certain rights, but the dog does not, the horse does not, the lion does not, okay? Because I, as a human being, I am the preferred creation of God, and God endowed certain rights in me to be. And in most societies, this understanding is sort of like, you know, reflected in the way we behave towards each other, towards everything else, okay? we're talking about individuals who consider animal rights, and then there's this tendency to laugh at them when these people are defending the rights of the forest and the rights of animals going extinct. And there's this tendency to laugh, like, you know, you're a tree hugger, they say. It's because those who see the notion of rights from this societal construct only see themselves as the holders of rights. They have rights and everything else does not. To suggest otherwise is insane. But we have to understand, if we're going to look at rights from the social construct, it has to undermine the same notion when it comes to rights for others. If only human beings have rights within the context of God giving them certain rights, then everything else does not or could not enjoy the same rights. So what I'm saying is that if we're looking at the concept of rights from a social construct, the right of a human being would undermine the rights of everything else. Anything that is not human would not have any rights which the human being himself should or must acknowledge. But I would go as far as to say that this is erroneous. This approach to the concept of rights sort of puts us in the wrong direction. So we're not getting closer to defining what the concept really means. So if we're looking at rights from this context, then it is interpreted erroneously. The second understanding of what the concept of rights mean is the notion of rights from an individual perspective. Now, we're not talking about a societal perspective. We're not talking about a collective perspective anymore. We're talking about the individual himself, how he or she perceives herself in the world in relation to others. Now, from this angle, the understanding itself does not necessarily come from a moral virtue, from a morality, from a moral standpoint. Rather, it encompasses certain inherent individual rights to exist. And this is so in relationship to others. So in other words, when we look at rights from the context of the individual has, at least the individual presumes that he has a right to exist in relation to others. So the same individual could look at himself and say, well, I have a right to be here in relation to you. And that could be another individual, okay? The individual look at himself and says, well, I have a right to be here. That could be in relation to the animals within the forest, okay? To every entity within the forest, the individual could look at himself and say, well, I have a right to be here. I have a right to exist, okay? And when we look at rights from this concept as well, it is also erroneous, okay? Because the individual in no time supersedes everything else in the natural. In no times, I say. So this understanding is also flawed because it implies a certain exclusivity in the natural. And that exclusivity, only human beings enjoy it. So what that means is that that exclusivity is embedded in the intrinsic being of the entity. So in other words, you know, being here as a human being automatically makes you, you know, a superior entity in relation to others. It is flawed, again, because this is going to lead to notions of superiority amongst men, where men look at themselves and say, well, this breed of human beings is superior, thereby have or enjoy or should enjoy more rights than others. So what that means is that the individual is entitled to certain rights. And because the individual is entitled to certain rights, that right is owed to the individual, okay? And the individual must receive that right by any means necessary. Even if it means that the individual has to take away the rights of others in the process. This creates a dichotomy, okay? Where rights is understood as a social construct in one hand. In this case, the collective decides what is rights, who deserves it. And right is understood as an individual construct, in which case the individual decides what is right and who deserves it. And in this case, the individual says, I deserve that right, right? So this creates a dilemma because both cannot be true at the same time. The individual could not have right over the collective. Just the same, the collective could not enjoy certain rights over the individual because at the end of the day, the collective is the result of several individuals whom generally have or enjoy a certain worldview, and that worldview is reflected in the way they approach certain individual rights. So both cannot be true at the same time. If we're going to look at rights from an individual standpoint, we cannot look at it from a societal standpoint the same way. If we're looking at rights from a societal standpoint, we cannot look at the concept from an individual standpoint. And that's why, to go back to what I said in the beginning of this podcast, is this notion that when we're talking about the human being within a social context, there are certain limitations which are inherent in the mere fact of being in a social context. Society itself is there to instill order, to remove any sense of disorder. So being part of society automatically takes away some of your at least presumed rights to be somewhere. Okay, so the two things cannot jive. If you want to be individual, you cannot evolve within a collective. Because if you're going to be within a collective where you are responsible for yourself within that collective, at the same time, the collective is there to enforce the fact that you are responsible for yourself. So it is somewhat nonsensical, to put it this way. Okay? But that's the way society is designed. That's the way society is constructed, where you live in a collective and you are also expected to have a certain individual responsibility. Okay, and that's, again, going back to the book, Citizen Obedience talks about what are the expectations of the collective in relation to the individual. In this case, we're talking about legal obligation. To what extent the individual is obligated to be, to what extent the collective is obligated to be, and to what extent both the individual and the collective enjoy a certain inherent obligation to be a certain way. So that's what this book talks about, and I encourage you to grab a copy when you have a chance, because it sort of goes into detail as to the difference between what the collective does and what the individual does. Okay, but to go back to this concept of rights from a collective standpoint and from an individual standpoint, these concepts do not jive because they sort of contradict each other. But we have to understand that this is how the world is designed. At least the world we evolved today, that's how it came about. The world we enjoy today came about this understanding that both the individual and the collective enjoy certain rights, right? And those rights, so, although they overlap, sometimes one supersedes the other. Right? Like sometimes the collective is going to supersede the individual, and other times the individual is going to supersede the collective. So at the end of the day, there's no continuity as to what a right is. It is not an accident that, you know, most societies have to have a legal system where there ought to be an arbiter. There ought to be some entity, which, by the way, is supposed to represent the collective, but he's doing so based on his individual understanding of what the collective wants. Right? So in this case, we're talking about a judge. We're talking about a legal system, a lawyer, and all that. So we're still, even though we are still within the framework of a collective understanding, but at the end of the day, the individual still gets to make that choice, right? So that tells you about the fluidity of the concept of rights, the concept of law. Again, go back to this book, Citizen Obedience, to have a better understanding of what a right is, what a legal obligation is. But we have to understand that when we're talking about rights within the two constructs, the collective construct and the individual construct, there is a dichotomy there. And the two concepts do not, they don't jive. They contradict each other. nonetheless, that's the way society is designed. That's the way society has been built. That's the foundation of every society, whether it's a secular society, whether it's a religious society, wherever you are, so long as the collective gets to decide what the individual does, and the individual is part of the collective, then we have this dichotomy. There's always this tension, and that's why there ought to be an arbiter to decide which is right in certain cases and which is wrong. But the problem is that the arbiter himself also comes in this with certain preconceived notions as to who has rights and who does not, right? And that's why all those layers of legal chambers, if you will, are there to override or to veto, if you will, what the lower group of legal representatives did. For example, you have different layers of legal representation, of legal jurisdiction, of legal powers, right? So those different layers are there to either corroborate what the previous layer did or to refute it. So at the end of the day, there ought to be an arbiter. Of course, there is the ultimate arbiter. We're talking about the Supreme Court in most societies, where a group of men, sort of a group of arbiters that are both individual in terms of they do not answer to no one. At the same time, they are collective because they are doing the affairs of the collective, right? So it's this idea that we have a group of men that sits on top, and their goal, at least their job, is to try to mitigate the disorder or to bring order to the chaos of a legal system. Okay, so this is to tell you the chaotic nature of rights of legal systems and whatnot. This is not to refute any society in terms of how they operate, but this is to point out, at least from a philosophical standpoint, there are certain foundations, there are the fundamentals of being in society, do not jive, right? The notion does not jive, right? So it's this idea that when we're talking about the individual and the collective, we ought to understand where one begins and where the other ends, okay? For the most part, they overlap, okay? We have to say that the world is different from what it used to be, let's say several years ago, right? In terms of legal parameters, the world has evolved. Understandings about morality, about God, about the law itself have evolved. And human beings have done a lot to try to mitigate. Thinkers have tried to come up with new ways to understand legal obligation, human rights, societal rights and collective obligation, authority and whatnot. And then this idea is to get closer to a better understanding of rights and what it is supposed to be. So as a result, there's this tendency to sort of, make sense of ideas about the law, about the justice system, about human beings in terms of their rights in the society, which had been adapted several years ago. Societies have sort of moved in a way to understand those underpinnings, at least the intellectual underpinnings of certain ways of looking at the world, looking at the collective, and looking at the individual. The world has sort of remained the same in terms of there are certain ideas that 200 years ago made sense, but today do not necessarily make sense. Yet these ideas are still part of our justice system. These ideas are still part of how we look at ourselves, how we define our worlds. Of course, we do not have any other options. And that's why when you look at some of the ideas that I've talked about and some of the ideas that I've tried to insert in the discourse about what is freedom, what is rights, we sort of realize that I don't see the world the way perhaps most people saw it hundreds of years ago. To me, the world today is a different world. Human beings live a different reality, and laws are supposed to reflect that. But we still live in this archaic world where what used to be hundreds of years ago are supposed to be today. Now, I have argued in other places that the human beings of yesterday have not really changed in terms of their foundation, but the conditions in which the human beings of today live is completely different from the conditions in which the human beings of yesterday used to live. So the laws of yesterday should not apply to the realities of today. Yet that's what we have. we have laws that are antiquated to a point where they sort of don't make sense at all. Yet they're part of who we are. They're part of our society. They're part of our legal system. We use those laws to take away human rights. We also use them to provide rights to others. This is the dichotomy we have to look into, we have to understand in order to have a good sense of society, in order to have a good sense of what it is that we deserve, or what it is that we are owed, and what it is we are supposed to do. In other words, it is by understanding those nuances, or at least these discrepancies between what was and what is, that would give us a sense of what ought to be. But there's also an important element to point out in this discussion. A right is not necessarily a human element. Whether or not it is collective, whether or not it is individual, that's not the point. The point is that a right is not supposed to be something that human beings see for themselves, give to themselves, afford to themselves, right? There's a certain inherency in what a right is. I will debate this concept in a different podcast, but for now, let us look at it a little bit closer. The definition of the term rights, whether it is from an individual perspective, or whether it is from a community or collective perspective, which we have already debated, is inherent. But it does not necessarily come from this human aura. In other words, the concept of rights is not necessarily a human thing, okay? Nature creates certain rights, which both the human being and everything else in nature enjoy. So when we're talking about the concept of the natural rights, it is not the right viewed from the perspective of one individual. It is not the right viewed from the perspective of a collective of individuals. It is a right that is inherently natural. And by the term natural, what I'm implying is that nature, the mere fact that you are, there is a certain inherent right to be. The mere fact that you exist, there is an inherent right to exist and to continue existing, okay? And in that case, it applies not only to human beings, but also to every living entity. Everything that exists has a right to exist or has a right to continue existing, okay? So in that case, in order to have a full grasp of what is a right or what right is, we also have to understand the origins of it, okay? And that takes us right back to nature, a mother nature, if you will. That takes us right back to that point of departure where everything that was or that is ought to be or should have been, okay? When we look at the question or the notion of rights from this perspective, the questions that come to mind are the following. Is a right something that one was born with, or is it something that is given to the individual as the individual evolves? In other words, is a right something inherent into the existence of the being? Do you have rights, or are you born with rights? This is a fundamental difference. Whether I have a right, or whether I am part of the right, or whether I was born with a right. The question as to whether I have rights implies the possibility that I might not have it. If a right ought to be given, that means the individual is devoid of it, at least right off the bat. If there ought to be an enforcement mechanism of rights, then that implies that the right itself is posited by men. Because natural rights ought not to be enforced or reinforced. It is natural. It is the right to be. Just like the fish has a right to be in the pond, or the fish has a right to be in the river. We cannot grab the fish out of the river and says, well, we're going to put the fish on the open and says, if you can be in the river, you should be able to be here too. You should be able to live on the savannah, on the land. Okay? So the fish has an inherent right to be in the ocean, in the river. Okay? The bird has an inherent right to fly. Of course, we're going to debate this concept a little further, but you have to understand that if right ought to be given, that means it is not inherent. The individual or the entity was not born with that right. Because if you were born with the right, then there's no need to enforce and reinforce it. There's no need to protect that right. So the concept is that as a human being, I have certain rights to be. I have a right to exist, which means I have a right to eat. I have a right to have a place to live. I have a right to provide for myself. I have a right to provide for my family because it is part of my existence, right? So in that case, it is not up to a government or it is not up to an entity to allow me to live that life, okay? And society is structured in such a way that the individual does not have that right in the beginning. There are certain conditions for the individual to enjoy such rights. There are certain things that society expects from the individual in order for him to enjoy certain rights. I mean, in order to be, in most societies, the individual ought to do certain things. It's a quid pro quo relationship, which implies that the individual does not have an inherent right to be right off the bat. The individual has to prove himself. And when he does not, whether he violated a rule or some laws within this particular social environment, the individual is taken back to a place where he cannot be unless he behaves a certain way. So what that means is that the individual never had an inherent right to begin with. That's all it means. Of course, again, this is the incongruity of society itself. But this understanding, again, going back to antiquity, that's the way we used to look at the world. Okay? That's the way, of course, there's this religious undertone to it. It's this idea that you as a person are not supposed to be a certain way. Well, who decides what am I supposed to be, when am I supposed to be, or how am I supposed to be? Of course, they're going to tell you God. And because God and the entity who enjoys the power or the authority of God, he gets to decide on behalf of God. That's the foundation of most laws. That is the foundation. Of course, it is a simplistic approach. It is a simplistic view of the world. But just in a nutshell, that's the foundation of who we are as entities roaming on this planet. Okay? Again, in my previous podcast, I talked about the idea that, you know, people may disagree with those views because, you know, what I am saying is not set in stone, but at least it is the way I understand the world. It might be an erroneous way of looking at the world. Nonetheless, that's the way I see the world. We live in a world that was designed a certain way hundreds of years ago. Despite our advancements in many areas, whether it's technology, intellectual, whatever it is, we still view our world from this prism because sometimes that's the best way to maintain the world we have the way we have it. Because if we allowed every individual to be the way their nature created them to be, then we would always have chaos. And we are supposed to mitigate that chaos, to control it. Thereby, society is there to instill order, to make the world be a certain way. So that the individual can never be the way nature intended him to be. Okay? Wondering whether I have rights implies the possibility that I might not have any rights. And to understand rights from this paradigm undermines the meaning of the term. Because rights does not necessarily imply something that one has or does not have. A right is part of being. If you exist, if you are, you automatically have an inherent right to be. The mere fact you exist, you have a right to be. And being in and of itself is not something that other entities ought to decide. So if we're going to look at rights from a collective standpoint, then we also say that the collective decides who has rights and who does not. And if we're going to look at the rights from an individual standpoint, that also implies that we have rights, but others do not. So we supersede others in terms of who we are, where we're supposed to be, and how we're supposed to be. Okay? So I think these nuances ought to be understood for what they are. So if you're going to look at the rights from the perspective that it has to be collectively given to some entity, what it implies that the individual never had rights to begin with. So the collective has to come together and come up with a way to protect that entity, to protect that individual, okay? The minute one is given the right to be, we are no longer talking about rights. If it must be given, enforced, reinforced by an entity, then we're not talking about rights. we're talking about privilege, because a right is inherent. I have a right to exist. But if it is up to a collective to decide that, if it is up to a group of individuals to decide whether I have a right to be, then my right to be in this environment is not a right. It is a privilege, which these entities, the collective, could take away at any time. And our society is structured today. That's why we have so many people in jail today. These people have been stripped of the rights to be. Of course, they're always going to tell you, being in jail, you still have the rights. You still have certain amenities. The fact that you're in jail, that doesn't mean you've lost. No. The mere fact that I cannot be the way I want to be is an indication that I am no longer who I was supposed to be. The minute you put somebody in jail, that individual no longer has rights, at least from your perspective. You could try to dress it different ways, saying, nah, we cannot have a society, etc. Well, this is part of another conversation. But if we're going to have a society, let's make a society where the individual can opt in and opt out. It's an exotic, if you will, idea, right? To talk about a society where the individual gets to be in and out. That's the only way to look at this term in terms of, being part of a collective. You do not have a choice to be a part of a collective. You were born into a collective. And that collective, right off the bat, is your mom and dad. Thereby, for a good portion of your existence, that existence is incumbent upon your mom and dad. Right off the bat. You can only be so long as mom and dad allow it. Okay? This idea that when we're going to extend that collective or that family nucleus into several families, where we're going to create a community where several families get together and decide to, or at least get together and determine the lives of their offsprings, right? That's how society has been structured. But there's a point where the individual never regains his independence. So even though you are an adult, you still have a father, in this case, the government. You still have a mother, in this case, a justice system, maybe a criminal justice system, a legal system, which decide when and how you are going to be. And I think we have to look at this concept within this framework. And that's the best way to approach the term right. Like I said, in upcoming podcast, I will debate the concept of rights a little deeper, because the concept itself is more complicated than the way I have explained it. But here, I wanted to make this comparison between how rights is understood collectively and how it is understood individually, and how, at the end of the day, it does not even exist. When we're talking about rights, it has to be inherent. It has to be natural. And the natural right to be oftentimes is undermined by the collective right to be or by the individual right to be. So we have to make a distinction between those three approaches. The collective approach to what a human right, to what a right is, the individual approach, and the natural approach. Of course, I'm not suggesting we should move back to the jungle, but might as well, because right now we are living in a jungle. The only difference perhaps is that certain entities within that jungle have the upper hand, and thereby others are right off the bat doomed to fail, and they are doomed to misbehave. They are doomed to be put in places where the rights, fundamental rights, is sort of taken away under the presumption that they are a problem for society, on the presumption that they represent chaos and disorder, okay, and all that. So we have to understand the concept of rights from this paradigm.